episode number 3 of the ChileKnitz podcast. My name is Connie and I am podcasting from Santiago de Chile. First of all, I wanted to start with a few introductions. A lot of people have introduced themselves in the Revelry group. I'll put the name of it on the down bar. So I have a little thing here with all the names because there were a lot of them and I couldn't remember them by heart, but I'm just going to read them out to you and say hello. First is ZoSew. She's called Donna. She is originally from Putnam, New York. KyMunchkin, Lisa from Kentucky. Magpie 60. She's Margaret from Pickering, Ontario, Canada. AuntieBeeBee, which is such a cute name. She's called Bee. Brigitte, I think. She's from Switzerland, near the Constance Lake. And funnily enough, I have actually been there, and it's really beautiful. Ramona from Toronto. Hi, Ramona. Thank you so much for introducing yourself. I'm sorry I missed your periscope today, but I was driving. IJ, she's from Georgia in the US. Athenaniketethys. I'm sorry, I'm just murdering that name. She's Heather from Washington State. Zatar, Marielle from Germany. She's currently now living in Dubai and soon to be moving to Amman in Jordan, which is crazy, like living so far away from home. And Devon, it says Devon-Kay, perhaps that's her Revelry name. And Devon from Florida. So hello everyone, thank you so much for introducing yourselves. I've replied to each one of you on the thread. Thank you so much for telling me how you start knitting or what your favorite craft is. It's really nice to hear different stories. On that note, since I've noticed that there's a lot of people from very, very, very places of the planet saying hello, I started a new thread on my group. It's called, I think, Window to the World, and I just put it there in case you guys want to share some pictures and photos of like the places that you like from where you live. I started the thread with a photo of Israel, and I explained a little bit about what's in the picture, so if you guys are interested in sharing, it would be really fun. Maybe I could use those photos and put them on the podcast for a little slideshow, and so other people can see where you live and like the gorgeous places of this planet. I think it's a lot of fun. I love traveling and I think it could be really interesting for everyone. If you have any comments about this, just let me know. Maybe you guys could help me improve the idea and make it something even better. Maybe we could have a giveaway every so often, like for the best photo. I don't know. You guys let me know what you think. So for now, the thread's there if you want to share with me where you live, or your favorite places. It doesn't really have to be where you live. Maybe it's like a place you like in your country. So yeah, I hope you find that a good idea. And I think it's really interesting because obviously I haven't been everywhere. And I think it's kind of like a really cool idea that we sort of show each other like different and beautiful and fun places. Well, next up I have the Ask OA section. AuntieBeeBee Bee from Switzerland, she's called Brigitte. I said hello to her in the introductions. She asked me two things. The first one is, where did you learn your English? It's excellent and you even have a dialect particular to an area, don't you? So thanks for the compliment. I learned English in school when I was little. My parents enrolled me in like a British school here in Santiago, and all my teachers were from the UK, different parts from the UK, like Scotland, Ireland, England, and all my subjects were in English until I was around 15, and then you could pick like your own sort of subjects, and most of them were in English and so on. So I got that from there, and then I moved to the UK. I lived there for a few years, I worked there after university. And then I moved to San Francisco, California, and I lived a few years over there. So I think my accent's a little bit muddled. I sort of get really tangled when I travel different places because I start like listening to the accents and it sort of sticks with me. And obviously when I'm here in Chile, I don't speak English to anybody. I only talk in English with Emma. And so she's learning, so basically my accent's like maybe neither here nor there. I don't know. I think I actually think in English because I lived so many years abroad, but I still communicate like everyday life in Spanish, so it's sort of like a little bit, I think it's like a mixed accent from all over the place. So the second question is, in Chile, do kids learn to knit or crochet in school? In Switzerland they do. So in my experience, I did not have knitting classes in school. We had like a class where we had to learn how to cook, and that was like a seasonal thing. So at some point we learned how to cook, and then in the same class we learned how to sew, and then basic things. And then on the next few months we had to learn how to like embroider and stuff like that. And then we had another, a completely different class that taught you how to make books and how to make things out of wood. Like, it was like a workshop, like of all those sort of crafty things. Knitting, although it was not part of the curriculum, although they did ask at some point for like knitted squares to make blankets for like homeless people or people in need and stuff like that, but you didn't have to make them yourself. You could ask your grandma or your mom if they knew how to knit. It would have been a lot of fun. Probably I would have been knitting for a lot longer than I have. I think I've been knitting for like 5 years. I think I would have liked it if I could have been knitting all the same. Imagine all the projects I would have finished, right? Like, oh my god, my list would be probably still as long as it is right now, but maybe I would have a lot more of the projects that I want in it done. And then I have another question. Lashanda, who is Lashanda Salomon 16 on Ravelry, she asked, what are the benefits of blocking knitwear, especially socks? Well, I'm gonna be really honest here. I have never blocked socks. I have sock blockers. I do have them, but I don't really use them to block socks like for example, like I block shawls. I just leave them there for a little bit to see like how they look, to show them, to take pictures of them. And the reason I don't block them is because I kind of wear them and then wash them and wear them and wash them. So if I really wanted to block them every time, I would have to have a lot of sock blockers, and I don't, maybe I should get them. What do you guys think? Same thing with hats. Like, I only once did block a hat that I knit and it ended up being too small for Emma. So I blocked it and then the size was perfect. So maybe some people block them to just loosen them up. Maybe to, I think that perhaps if you knit like a lace pattern in the sock, you maybe block it, but still, like, you're still wearing it and sort of stretching out, so I'm really not sure. So if anyone knows if like there's a specific reason to block socks, please let me know so I can reply to Lashanda, because it's, she got me thinking there, like, oh yeah, why would people block their socks? Because like I never have, for the reasons I just told you. Same with hats. I have never knit mittens, but I think I wouldn't block them either. Well, so Lashanda, I'm sorry. That's my opinion. I don't know why they would, but at least for shawls, it's to bring out the pattern the way that it's supposed to, you know, that the yarn doesn't and normally come out the way that it comes out after you block it, so it sort of blooms after blocking, especially with shawls. I do block sweaters though, so those you wear and wash at the same time. It's a very strange thing why I don't block socks, but there you go. Like, I have no excuse. Again, if anybody knows, please, please let me know. Get in touch with me and let me know. So now there's a. I wanted to have a small section within the podcast called "Show Off Your Knits." So last episode I showed you a few of my knits, and since I can't knit at the speed of light, which I would like that so much, I decided that perhaps you guys can show me your knits and I can show the world what you guys have been doing, and at the same time you'll give me more ideas of things to put on my knitting list. It's gonna be so long after all this. Some people sent me a few pictures on the group, and I'll put them here so you guys can see. It's not a lot of them, but I'm hoping that in time you guys will start sharing what you're knitting and I'll just show everybody else. The yarn does not have to be ChileKnitz yarn, it could be any yarn. This is just to show off what you've been doing. In this section though, I'd rather that people show off the finished object rather than the actual sort of like work in progress, just because you can actually see the shape and, or if you're wearing it in the picture, like how it looks and all of that. So here's the pictures. I hope you like them. Show off your knits section, I wanted to show off another shawl that I don't wear it very much because I don't have many clothes that match it, but whenever I can, I do. It's the, and probably you guys have seen this many times, it's the lattice shawl by Maria Monska. I'll write the details down here. And I knit it out of Joel Draper, her Esopus yarn, and I'm really sorry, but I don't remember the colorways at all. But these colors, they came in, I'll show off a photo of this. This yarn came in a Laura Nelken sort of like MCAL. I think it was for last year or the year before, my husband Daniel gave me as a Christmas gift this subscription to the Laura Nelken MCAL. So for the whole year you got 4 mystery knit-alongs. I like mystery knit-alongs, but for some reason, and I like Laura Nelken's designs, but for some reason in this opportunity I decided to wait to see how the project was knitting up, and I did not really like, I mean I liked the design, but all of them were things that I wouldn't necessarily wear, and so I didn't use the yarn to knit those projects. And I was looking for a project to use this yarn because it's super squishy, like even after blocking it's just, it's so high twist, it's very round and soft, I really like it. And so I found this pattern and I really like the way, because these colors came together, like paired up. And I was looking for a 2-color project, and then I saw this pattern and I really liked it. It's a fairly simple pattern. It just took me a really long time to finish this because as I told you guys before, I have little kids and this comes with a chart, and so it's kind of hard to focus for me when I'm having like my kids interrupting me all the time, and so I made tons of mistakes, I had to rip back a ton of times, but in the end I'm super happy that I sort of finished it. I love it, it's huge, but the problem is that the color doesn't really match anything that I own. So normally I would wear it with like white, just plain white underneath, and jeans. Not right now because it's summer. It's so hot, guys. You won't believe it. But yeah, I think I would totally recommend this knit. I am been thinking about knitting another one in different colors so that I can sort of like wear it with more things. Definitely more for like tone or solids. I wouldn't use highly variegated yarn for this. Maybe like a soft speckle. I think it would be really nice as well. I think if I knit this again though, I think I would probably use the opposite of this, like probably like pastels or like something a lot more muted so that I can wear it with different things. I would like to explore maybe knitting this with thicker yarn, like this is fingering, maybe sport weight or even DK to make like a huge shawl, like for more like the winter, so when it's cold, can just like wrap it up, be really nice. So yeah, that's my show off, my knit show off of the day. Next up is my whip. I'm gonna disappoint you guys, but I have not knit or crochet any more Christmas baubles since the last time I podcasted. That's 2 weeks ago. I did start one, but I never got to finish it. So I have two different, I have it in my ChileKnitz bag. So yeah, I've started these little, you start by making two circles that look the same. And then once they reach a certain point, like I'm one or two rows away from, you grab the bauble and then you just place them there. And obviously this is like knit up till here. And then you start crocheting them together until you get the whole thing covered. I'm gonna finish this before Christmas. So today's Thursday, Christmas is on Saturday. I promise I'm gonna finish this by Saturday, definitely. I'm looking at my Christmas trees behind the camera and there's two baubles. I already hung up a few little mini socks I made throughout the year, and there's gonna be the third bauble, and I'm gonna keep the project in this bag throughout the year so I can slowly start making more. Maybe next year the tree's only gonna be covered in crochet baubles. I think that's gonna look awesome. And maybe crochet baubles and mini socks. What do you guys think? I think it'll be super cool. Next, I've been working a little bit on my Seven Seas of Rye shawl. By the way, the baubles, I am crocheting them with a 3mm crochet hook, and I am using this brand of cotton for them. It's called Lanas Stop. It's called Algodon Soft, which means soft cotton. This is, if I'm not mistaken, it's a Spanish brand. They have a lot of really nice yarns, merino, cottons, and some acrylics as well, and some sort of blends of acrylic and merino. I have these little balls. They come in all sorts of colors, and they don't have specific names, just numbers. If you guys want to find out, if you guys want, maybe you guys have them where you live, and you want the same colors, just let me know. I can send the information to you. It's just colors in numbers, so that's it. So Seven Seas of Rye. Last time I podcasted, I was here. The rows are getting really long. Obviously it's getting all scrunched up on the sides. It's quite large already. I do want to make it a lot bigger. I'm on the second skein. And not very much of it has been used. So let's see. I thought perhaps I was just gonna use the second skein and just, because I have three, and just maybe use the third one for a different project, because the color in this one so a little bit darker than the rest. I'll just see when I'm reaching the end of this how big this is, and if I'm sort of happy with that, I'll just stop knitting there, and I'll use the other skein for a different project. This yarn is called Handmaiden, and I think, Handmaiden Kasbah, I think is the specific type of yarn. It's an 80-10-10 merino cashmere nylon blend in the charcoal colorway. I'm knitting them on 3.5mm needles. These are my carbons, and 3.5mm needles is a US 4. Sometimes I forget to say all these details, especially the translation from millimeters to US conversion. If I don't say it, I will put it on the down bar so you guys know. And if I forget it, please forgive me and let me know. Because I'm sort of all over the place sometimes and my brain just forgets everything. All the details. I have one more whip, and then I'm going to show you a few finished objects. So, I started a pair of socks, a blueberry waffle pair of socks, with a yarn that my lovely friend Julia from the Happy Knitting podcast gifted me a while back, and it's got a story, this yarn, because I saw her knitting with it on her Instagram. She posted a picture of some socks she was making with this yarn, and she wasn't sure she liked it, and I really loved it, and so I told her on a comment, like, no, keep on knitting them, they're looking gorgeous, I really like the yarn and stuff. And then she PM'd me and said, you know what, I really don't like it, would you like me to send you the yarn? And I'm like, seriously? Oh my god, I would love that. So we had like an impromptu yarn swap. I sent her some minis and one of my colorways, I think it was Neon Diva. And she sent me this yarn that she dyed herself. I have no idea what yarn it is. But I just love the colors. I think it looks like cotton candy, don't you guys? I'm using contrasting toes, heels and cuffs, and for that I'm using the hedgehog fibers that I was using for my other socks. This is the Harajuku colorway, and it's like a very cotton candy-y sort of pink, which is super, super sweet. And so yeah, I started this a couple of days ago. I have the sock bug, you guys. I don't know what's happening to me. Normally I just want to knit shawls, but lately I just want to knit all the socks all the time. I'm going mental. I think I sort of want to use up all the yarn that I have caked up, and socks are like the perfect way to cast on like a quick project and bring it along everywhere with me. So I'm super excited about these. These are my first pair of blueberry muffin socks. I'll put the details here. I'm knitting them on 2.25mm carbons. That's a size US 1. And speaking about carbons, before, a few months ago, I only had these sort of needles, the carbons to knit socks. I have a few pairs of these, same size. But when I went to Rhinebeck this year, and I was with Chelsea and Sue in this, it was a very strange yarn shop, because it had like, it was like a shop that they had all sorts of things, sort of like kitchen things, toys, you know, a menagerie of things you would like. And then at the back there was this like lovely yarn shop with like all sorts of brands of lovely yarn. So when you enter the shop, to the right, there was a huge wall with a ton of chago needles hanging on the wall. And Sue told me, you should get some of these, you're gonna really like them. And she was like, you're gonna really like them because the cable is really stiff. And at the time I thought that was not a good thing. So I bought one pair of needles to start like a specific project. And then I really liked it because the cable didn't sort of like get, you see this cable sort of like comes in the way all the time and it starts getting really fiddly, but before I didn't really notice because I didn't know any different. And so I got one pair of 2.25 millimeters Chiago needles, and oh my god, I need to get more because I'll show you. The socks I cast on with those, they literally flew off my needles. Like, I don't know if it's the cable, I'm not sure if it's the needle. The fact that it's pointier really helped me with the pattern that I was using for that specific sock. So now I feel that I'm knitting slow with these. So next time I travel, I'm definitely gonna get like a few more pairs of Chiago 2.25. I actually really like that the cable was a lot stiffer, and the thing that I liked the most, although sometimes it was detrimental to my knitting because the stitches came off, the join is quite seamless because on the carbons, at least for me, I feel that my stitches snag a little bit, and that didn't bother me. It doesn't really bother me now, but it does slow you down a little bit, and what happened, so I was like, oh, this is so much fun and so much faster. And so well, this happened, right? I started them and I finished them in, I think it took me 4 days, because out of the four I didn't knit on 1.5, but I just flew off my needles. This is my Enchanted Apple colorway, my strong sock base. So after those speckled space socks, I cast on a pair for Daniel for Christmas. The first time I knit him socks, they were too big for him and super wonky because I was not very acquainted with the whole sock knitting thing. These socks also took me no time at all. I also knit them on those 2.25 US ones Chiago needles. My sock blockers are too small for them, but here they are. I can't really show them well, but you can see like the yarn. This I knit with some yarn I bought in Canada. It's called Lana Grossa. I think it's a German brand. It's kind of like Regia. And I bought this yarn specifically to knit socks for Daniel. But he didn't, I think he saw it, but he's probably forgotten about it. So, and since I know he's not going to watch the podcast, I can show you guys. I haven't put it on Instagram because I know that he looks at my Instagram all the time. He likes to see what people write on my photos, and he gets super excited when people like what I knit and when they like my yarn. So now you can see it, and after Christmas I'll post a photo of him wearing them. There is one more finished object I have that I completely forgot to show you last episode, and I completely forgot to bring it down again, so I'm gonna go find it and I'll be right back. Okay, so here it is. It's my treehouse hat treehouse hat by Mandrens, I think. Yes, I'll put the name down here. I'm gonna take it off now because it's really hot. So yes, I finished this. It was a really fun knit. I knit it out of woolen vine yarns in the mist colorway, and I put this lovely pom-pom on top. And this pom-pom was a gift from my friend Caroline from Germany. She sent me a few pom-poms a while back, and it sort of really matched this yarn, so they look really good together. I can't wait for winter so that I can wear it. I think I might definitely knit another one in a different colorway. I have a pink pom-pom just like this one. I think I have another woolen vine yarn that is sort of like this sort of muted color, but in pink, that it would look really nice with it. And I might use the same pattern actually, but perhaps I'll just try a different one just to have like different hats for winter. but I love it. I think everyone should knit one. It's such a fun knit, and I think it goes with everything. It's super cute. Emma loves it. I think she's gonna wear it more than I will. She's been trying it on. I have it in my closet, and she just pulls it out and puts it on all the time. And it's so hot that I have to like run after her, just take it off. Otherwise, I think she's gonna like faint. But yeah, treehouse hat. Everyone should have one. And that's all for finished objects. I'm sorry, I have my notes down here, that's why I'm looking at it all the time. Shop news, I reopened my shop a few days ago. I want to thank you all for your support and your response to the reopening. It was lovely to see that so many people were expecting it and waiting for it. I'm super happy. I've mailed all the yarn already. It's on the way to you. I'm hoping that because it's Christmas, it doesn't take longer than it normally should. Perhaps it will a little bit. I'm really far from you guys, so be patient. Normally it takes from 12 to 15 working days to the yarn to get from here to anywhere on the planet, but I'm thinking maybe with the holidays it might take a little bit longer. I did send tracking numbers to everyone that bought some yarn so you guys can see where the yarn is and sort of see how, or more or less calculate how long it's going to take to get to you. And I think that's it for me today. Next up is the art and yarn section. I'm going to film it with my mom tomorrow. She's not here right now. I just decided to film this separately because it takes me a little bit of time to get this whole thing done. And hello again. This is the art and yarn section. Before we start, I forgot to say something yesterday when I was recording the other part of the podcast. There's a surprise for all of you. There's a surprise that a lot of podcasters a few podcasters from around the world have been planning and organizing. I will upload a video explaining all of this on Monday after Christmas, so please be aware that it's going to happen. I'll post it on Instagram anyway, but just so you know. So now
I will present a Spanish artist from, well, he won.
¿Qué es el que era primero?
Oh, I'm his mom. Her mom. I'm her mom. My name is Solange Cano. I'm an artist. Also, I work on that. And my life is art. I love art. That's why Connie invited me here to be with you.
Before I start,
what?
I think you want to see this.
Yes. Look at that one.
This is the Jackson Pollock skein. It's this.
Yeah.
You haven't seen it before, have you?
No.
It's based on the Guardians of the Secret painting. I'll put it here so you guys see it. And I'll put some photos of this so you guys can see it up closer. I used all the colors in the painting. It's definitely not something I would have dyed by myself, but I actually really like it. And I dyed it in a sparkly base because I thought like the painting had lots of white in it, but the contrasting colors were really strong, so I thought maybe the sparkliness would also add to the brightness of the yarn. So do you like
beautiful.
It?
Beautiful. Yes. Really? Congratulations, my dear.
Okay.
My sweetie.
I'll put this in the shop in case anybody wants it. The Bravo skein went when I reopened my shop, and I already sent it, and I completely forgot to add a card with a photo of the inspiration painting, but from now on, and with this skein, starting with this skein, I will do that for anyone who gets
it.
Okay, so
Well, first of all, from Jakpolk.
Yeah.
It was a lady that write that something about spring.
Yeah, we have a correction about the Jackson Pollock stuff that Ramona talked about last week. I'm going to write on the down bar here the name of the person that helped us with this. But she said Jackson Pollock hadn't lived in...
No, yes, he did, but when he was little...
So he hadn't lived in Palm Springs?
Not in Palm Springs, but very nearly... Not in Palm Springs especially, but he was living at California for a while when he was young. But his work was in Spring, near New York. And he died there, and he has a tomb. He has a tomb there with her wife.
His wife.
He was his wife. Yes. And my English is still, but I'm trying. Well, today I choose Joan Miró. He is a Catalan painting. He is from Spain, Spanish also. I choose it because he has pure color, so we can find a very different painting here in the John that Connie is going to be. It's hard what I choose to her today. He is a Cubist painting. At the first time, well, he was born like an artist. At the 7 years old, he began to paint. At 19 years old, he went to an art academy, but his parents didn't want him to be like an artist. So, yeah, really. So he studied. In that time, it was like that. And he studied commercial. He worked a little bit on that one. He was very boring on that.
Bored,
yes. And then he go to the art with a lot of imagination. He began like a Cubist. Constance is going to put some pictures. And you are going to
look the difference.
Yeah, you're going to be to see the different on and the growing on of his art along his time, or his life. You know, he lived at 90 years old. After I will speak about that, he was really a great artist. He began like a Cubist painting. After he changed a little bit like a magical realistic painting, and then he came into the movement of surrealistic painting with other ones like Picasso and all that
like Dali?
Yes, like all that movement. That they call that part of the moment, it was some part that they call it Fauvism.
All right.
Yeah, so he belonged to that moment also. He worked with symbols. He began to put a lot of symbols in his work. They were not so big canvas, but he began to paint bigger and bigger. And his symbols, it's a lot of symbols about women, birds, stars, and many symbols that get inside have different meanings. For example, he has in his bedroom, for example, he paint full of stars over the ceiling.
His bedroom?
In his bedroom, cool. Yeah. There in Spain, two big museums of him, just of him. One at Palmas de Mallorca, where he lived at the last, and at Barcelona, where he studied and where he was living a lot. his work was being interpreted like a recreation of childlike. He lived, he moved, and after, when was the war, began the war in Spain, he moved to France. So in France, they got very good critic for his work, but not for the first time, because at France he did his first exposition, and he didn't sell no painting at all.
Really?
Oh. At the first time, but after, well, sold out everything. During the beginning of the Second War, he returned to Spain to work. He's a genius, really. I can talk a lot of many pictures because he began to move in different meaning of his soul. So he was finding new tapes that always he was putting that tape, and he was moving to an expression that very simple. So the last part of his work that is very interesting is very simple. It's just how can we say, simple,
minimalist.
He has also, he was a sculptor also. He did 500,
really?
500, his legacy is 500 sculpture, 3,500 engraven, 200 of
oils,
2,000 oils, 5,500 drawing and collage, and the sculpture. He has a park. At Spain, at Barcelona, that you can see his sculpture. They are the same as the shapes of the painting. First of all, he did it in one color or in metal, in bronze. But after he began to put color over, so you can see the pictures and you can see the sculpture. He has a special,
prize.
He won the prize of the Guggenheim Museum. Well, he has at Paris, he has also murales,
murals,
big murals. We can find a big one at Paris at the UNESCO. He's prolific in his work.
Okay guys, I'm really sorry for all the interruptions. I stood up before because the dogs were barking outside and I could hear them, and I didn't want you guys to be hearing that all the time while my mom was talking. Then the battery died, so we had to sit around to wait until it charged a little bit, because my spare one is in my studio, so I can use it right now. And we completely forgot what my mom was saying before we stopped filming, and so...
Well, Constanza told me, you don't speak, just speak shorter, but with Miro, really, I cannot speak shorter because he's a great artist. I choose the gold of the Azur, that picture.
I put a photo of it here.
Yeah, that is the world.
The new challenge?
The new challenge that you are going to have.
It's a fun one.
It
looks like a matching...
Matching like this. you will like it. The last thing that I didn't told you that Miro was very connected with the poetry. So you can find poetry inside his pictures.
And there's a lot of symbols inside the painting. So if you have time and you're curious, please look it up and check them out thoroughly, because there's a lot of little details that you might like.
In all his life.
Exactly. So we're gonna go now. I'm gonna put a few bloopers at the end of this video because something really funny happened before. And
no, don't put it up. Yeah, you're really a
mum. And we'll just say Merry Christmas. I hope you guys have a wonderful holiday. I'm going to try and get this uploaded tonight or tomorrow, the 24th, so you guys can view the episode whenever you want. And I...
Merry Christmas, yes, for all. Peace and everything. The best for the world.
Exactly. Bye.
Bye. Water now.
Okay.
You need to be sorry. Yes. You need to do it again this.